Hey, Toby. What you doing? You want to go outside? Yeah, me too. It's kind of gloomy. What about you, Tuck? What about you? What about you? Hello. Oh, that's not for you. What are you doing in there? All right, let's go. Let's go outside. Come on.
Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party. How's everybody doing? Hope you're good. I'm great. It's a beautiful day.
Not really. That was sarcasm. There's storms rolling in. It's like 40 degrees. Spring got here and it just decided to get colder. So go figure. It's typical, right? What are you whining about? What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? Huh? You say hello? Okay, guess not.
But seeing as how it's such a beautiful day, I thought, what a great opportunity to go ahead and do a March garden tour. Let's start in the English garden with the beautiful boxwood and privet maze. Look at how beautiful and gorgeous. So much lush greenery to enjoy over here. Oh, and of course, let's not forget the rose garden. Look at all these lush floribundas and grandiflores. So many just ready to be picked and snipped and thrown into vases. And over here, well, there's actually stuff going on over here we can talk about. The rest of the garden's just a bunch of mulch and brown stuff. But the privet hedge is actually looking pretty good. There's a little bit of foliar burn showing up on this one over here, but otherwise, I call these privets. Laurels, these are the laurels, the skip laurels. I don't know if I said privet or not, I don't know. They're starting to bud, which is going to be fun. These will get lots and lots of little flowers on them that'll have little berries, which the birds enjoy. And I have to say, this winter was very mild, which was the perfect time for having this hedge in the ground. These are hardy to zone 6 and they're up on a raised berm, which is a little bit more exposed. So having their first winter being nice and cool and mild means that I didn't really have to worry about the cold getting them this year. I was worried I was going to have to like wrap them in frost cloths and all kinds of things, but I was lucky enough to not have to do any of that. They did get a spray with an anti-transpirant all the way back in November, but I don't even know if they needed it. I mean, in situations where you have this foliage back here that you can see has kind of started to burn a little bit from the wind, that's not great, but it could be so much worse. I was worried when I planted this hedge that by the time spring came around, this entire thing would look like that. And it's just like one branch. That's no big deal. I mean, they look a little bit rough, but really not bad at all compared to what I thought they might look like come springtime. Just a little burn. No big deal at all. And then down below those, we have the... what are these called? I think I mentioned these in a vlog not too long ago, but the Petasites japonicus. I had these planted, just a few, kind of scattered about in this berm, I don't know, a couple years ago. And every single year they spread and spread and spread. And I put in here the variegated, the Petasites japonicus variegata. And then the other one should be the Petasites japonica gigantea, I believe. And they have very different flowers. In the early spring, very late winter, they put up these flowers, usually before any foliage or usually with just like a little bit of foliage. And they look pretty cool. You can see that. Look at how those buds lay inside the plant, almost like little buttons that are getting ready to open up. And then when they do, it's just kind of little white things. That's on the japonicus variegata. But on the other one, pardon the dog toy, the gigantea, this is the first year I've seen them flower. So this will be, I think, their third season in the ground. From just, like I said, there were like four of the variegated, one of the giganteas. Look at the flowers on the giganteas. Can you see that? Let me get closer. These start up from the ground. These really cool little purple cones. They look kind of like a hyacinth, don't they? Like an alien version of a hyacinth. They're very short and small, but they're kind of thick. They're really thick and sturdy. And they start to open up and climb, and they look really cool. Doesn't that look neat? Isn't that a neat, interesting flower? I know it's not typical of what people think of when they hear spring, but I don't know, I think it's cool. Then a little bit different from daffodils and pansies and tulips. Not really comparable, but it's spring flowers. And here's another one coming up through this little sidewalk crack over here. And then here's some that are more mature, so you can see how they kind of come up and stretch and don't like to be focused on. Over here under the base of this mimosa tree, it's a little bit warmer, so these are a little bit further along. The flower's not further along on that one, but the foliage is. And look at it, you can see them all the way up there on the hill. So this is not something to plant in an area where you don't want it to get filled in. Because I originally planted just a few of them over here. And I did that with the intention of wanting them to eventually fill in the front of this berm and to kind of go up this hill where nothing else will grow and it'll just be really big, interesting foliage, especially with the variegated one, because those leaves, to me, remind me of when you see like a giant pothos down in Florida or any place you've been on vacation. They'll use them to fill in areas. They'll crawl across the ground with their great big leaves and crawl up things. These won't crawl up anything, but they still will have that nice yellow variegation, especially back in those dark areas. It'll help draw the eye back and look really pretty. You have to take my word for it. It's not much to show. Things are just getting started for the year. And the red buckeye is starting to bloom. Starting to flush out. It's a little bit hard to see here. These are a really nice plant if you want a good tropical vibe. Again, you have to take my word for it. The leaves, the leaf formation is very similar to like a Schefflera. It will grow up into a nice big tree and they get these long plumes of red flowers on them. And the hummingbirds and pollinators love them. And this one has taken forever to get going because it was actually a pretty hard plant to find. I eventually got it from mail order natives. It's just a little twig that I put back there, and then the dogs kept trampling it year after year after year. Then finally I put something around it and it was able to get big enough that they couldn't trample it. So this tiny little thing is actually probably like 6 years old. I know I need to get rid of the bench. It's a sentimental thing. This was my grandma's, although I did find out last year that apparently she died on this, so I'm not feeling as attached to it as I was before. So that would be a good thing to do with being stuck at home, is take this apart and get that out of here. Just keeping things on a light note and positive over here. This honeysuckle needs to be pruned, doesn't it? I think it may need to just get cut all the way back to the ground because it's gotten so unruly, and the way it's growing, it won't go up a trellis or anything like that because it's just so bunched up down below. I think cutting it back would just kind of be a good chance to sort of hit the reset on that, so I'll probably do that in the next week or so, maybe even sooner. I'm waiting for the hydrangea trees to start to bud out. They're kind of starting to, sort of. You can see some little action in there. I'd say in like a week or so's time, those will be big enough where I'll know it's okay to go ahead and give this hydrangea a cutback. But what's the point if it's being eaten alive by a honeysuckle, right? So I need to get that done, but it's just not quite time yet. I figure it'll be easier to do the honeysuckle and this prune at the same time, since the honeysuckle crawled into this and it's just a big old tangled mess right now. Creeping Jenny's starting to show up and do its thing. That's exciting. Those are one of my favorite plants. They're so abundant, and I know they can be a weed in some areas for some people. They haven't quite gotten to that level here. Maybe they have, but it's not bothering me because it can't really spread into the yard or anything with this path and the cement and everything being here. Those are at the base of these hydrangea trees. And now this hydrangea tree, this one last summer, it was in a few different videos I talked about this. The pot that this is in somehow just got clogged up, and we had tons of rain last June and it just drowned the poor thing. And I lifted it out, cleaned up the root ball and got better drainage going so that it could hopefully survive. But it was one of those things where I was like, really, unfortunately, I'm gonna have to wait until next year to see how it does, if it will rebound. I'm not really seeing anything that looks very promising on this plant, unfortunately. I'd give it a little bit of a scratch test, but I just cut my fingernail, so it's not really gonna do any good. But usually with something like this, you can do a little scratch test, get some bark off, and if you see green under there, that's a good sign. I don't know, we'll just have to give this a little bit more time. The bungee cords was there to help hold it back because the thing was leaning forward. I don't think I need that anymore though, do I? Wow, here's something else. I didn't even know it was here because it had been eaten by the honeysuckle. I'd say that can probably go, right? That's not looking very good. I don't need to hold on to that. Give this a few more weeks, see if things warm up enough and get some growth out of it. If not, it's okay because I have an extra and I can swap it out, but it wouldn't be ideal because I've had these for a long time. These trunks have started to get nice and thick and girthy on there, but I mean, what's the point if the plant's dead? Then it doesn't matter. And still have this giant big gap here from that pine tree that also got drowned last year from all of the rain. And this was the Lespedeza. Need to get that. I cut that one back all the way to the ground. I meant to do that in the fall. I guess I just forgot. I was actually pretty good this year about getting a lot of my spring stuff done in the fall, which is actually really nice that I don't have to spend a ton of time cleaning up all the fall mess. I mean, there's still plenty of cleaning to do out here, but nowhere near what it'd be if I hadn't done that back in the fall time. So that's gotta get out of here somehow. I don't know how, with this wall here and the gate being narrow, getting machinery in here might be kind of tricky.
I don't know. It's something to think about. They're, I mean, I'll probably just take a chainsaw to it and an axe and start cutting away at the roots and see what I can do there. But this is an area that I'll either replant a tree in, depending on whether or not I can get out to a nursery, you know, it's because of quarantine. I'm trying to stay at home, just like everybody else. You know, that'll be something that has to wait until probably early summer and figure that out. But I do have a bunch of like canna bulbs and things like that I might put back here. And maybe I'll just do like a toss together garden in the meantime with a stump in the middle. Hopefully the stump won't be there. There's a needle palm back here. All of the needle palms did fantastic this winter. There's a little bit of leaf burn on there, but this one's looking good underneath this Norway spruce here. I have an azalea when it was a bonsai, and then I just let it go and it just turned back into just a regular azalea bush. That needs to be pruned. I need to do something about that. Then over here, I have these water garden bowls that were set up last year. I brought my lotus back out thinking it would like get woken up. I don't know if it will though. I had to cover this one though. This had a water lily in it. Still does, but I had to cover it with another pot because Tucker, as you just saw, kept drinking out of it, and that water is really gross. He was having some stomach problems. I think I may have like blacked it out too much. So I don't know. I'm gonna uncover it. I have to get my hoses reconnected so I can give that a good flush and won't have to worry about Tucker drinking from it, but still, I mean, it's not looking very pretty. I'm not looking forward to cleaning that out. Have some spring stuff going on, some plants that are waking up from winter time. This is the Primo Wild Rose Heuchera. Right here, you can see that tag a little bit better. The foliage on this one is absolutely beautiful. So this is, you can see, that's its new growth. You need to come in here and get that all cleaned up and cut out. I have whole bunch of heucheras ready for planting so far. And same thing here, these are silver brocade artemisias. See that tag right there? Beautiful silvery foliage. They're waking up, ready to go in the ground sometime soon, hopefully. Another needle palm did great. Didn't have to protect it at all this winter. I didn't have to do anything with the needle palms or my sabal palms this winter. And see, here are my other needle palms. They're getting pretty big. They're about 3.5 feet tall. And probably, I'd say, a good 4 to 5 feet wide. Really big and bushy. Little bit of tip burn there on the edges, but otherwise, they're looking great. I haven't had to do anything with them. I do have some perennials kind of placed out over here that I overwintered, and I was kind of toying around some ideas of what I want to do with them. Still just a little bit too soon to plant, but I'm, you know, it's fun to toy around with ideas. A steel bay waking up. That's going to get planted over here for sure. I love a steel bays. And this one, does the tag have picture? It does. It's called the Mighty Chocolate Cherry. I don't know if you can see that, but it has dark foliage and beautiful, like, electric fuchsia plumes on it. It's an absolutely stunning steel bay. Sable palmetto, zero protection. I mean, it's not the most big and impressive looking plant, but still, zero protection in zone 6A, 6B. That's a testament to how mild this winter was. More heucheras. Tricolor sedum waking up also. I have this Ocorus here, which is a variegated sweet flag. That overwintered absolutely beautifully, didn't it? Wasn't expecting that at all. This is kind of a warm area where I have it tucked in. I have it like surrounded with my excess pots, so that, you know, that would account for why it did so well probably. There's not quite as much exposure to wind and whatnot. Teddy bear magnolia is over here looking fantastic. I mean, it's still in its pot, leaning against the house. That's kind of the warmest spot I could think of to put it. Did great this winter too. And then the palms. I have the palm trees out here. The mule palms in the back and the windmills in the front with all my little potting projects going on over there. It's not much. There's not much to look at yet, but it's just nice to get outside, walk around and get some fresh air and kind of toy around with ideas and things like that. There's a lot of uncertainty right now. I still find it fun to sit back and look at these big open spaces and kind of get that canvas painted in my mind. I pass a lot of time that way. Too much time. Like, I mean, I will sit back and stare at a blank garden space for, I don't know, half an hour sometimes and just kind of think about the different things that could be done with that space. And then, you know, you have to remember, like, it's not really a blank space, right? Because things just haven't woken up yet. March was pretty warm and things were looking good, and then spring got here and it is cold. Like, my hand is very cold right now. But there's still lots of little things to get excited about and get into. We did have some snow unexpectedly the other day, and the lettuce kind of started to flop from that. Been making sure to go through and kind of fluff it and play with it a little bit, help toughen the plants up so they'll have more of a stiff, sturdy growth. I have tons of pansies and bushes and all kinds of things ready to grow. Okay, well, maybe not tons, but some. A decent amount, considering I'm gonna be stuck at home for who knows how long. There are plenty of things to play with. This is an autumn carnation encore azalea. This was in my last video, so there's not much else to say about it, but it's just a really pretty azalea. And the cactus are starting to wake up. These opuntias, the prickly pears, they tend to fall down in the wintertime, and then when things get a little bit more mild, they start to pop back up. So those are looking good. Everything's waking. You get the point. Things are waking up. Happy spring, everybody. Can I help? What are you doing? You're not supposed to be back here. Can I help you? What are you doing? What are you doing? You broke the rule. You're not supposed to cross the line. Let's go back. Come on. You gotta go back. Let's go. See, Toby knows the rule. Don't cross the line. Don't make a fool of me, Toby. Toby. Oh, you guys are bad. No, literally, that's bad. Come on. Get back. Go on. Yeah, you're cute, but I don't think so. Not getting away with that. Yeah, I hope everybody's doing well. What are some things you guys have planned for your gardens? Or just what are you doing to pass some time? Just thought I'd check in, say hi, walk around and show my beautiful garden off. That was sarcasm. Things aren't looking too hot right now. Comment down below or just say hi. I love talking to everybody. My social media is down there too. Hi, Tucker. You good boy. Oh, and then, you know, the whole YouTube thing. The like, subscribe, and the notification bell. That way you know when new videos come out. Oh, look how girthy that mule palm's gotten. That is looking really nice. Nice, healthy hybrid palms. I like these queen palms too. I also just noticed that I didn't get the red tape off there. These were hanging out the back of the car. You know, anything that sticks out more than I think 3 to 5 feet, you got to put those red flags on them, like just a safety thing. At least that's how it is where I live in St. Louis and Missouri, but that's if you get that off there, no big deal. I'm actually probably going to lay these on their side because they're supposed to have some bad storms and they'll just get blown over, so I may as well just lay them down gently. Right,
I had to come inside. It's too cold out there. My hands are starting to like sting from the cold, which is fine. It's time to go anyways. Everybody's having a great day, a great life, and everything's just going beautifully for you. Why won't you focus? There we go. Try and get that extreme close-up of a palm frond and just failed. That's kind of nice. I like that. As always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye.